opened were gates of unforgettable bliss. Two lives were locked within an earthly heaven, and fate and grief fled from that fiery hour. Obviously, very grief now there, because you are burning into the same flame, bright flame, you see. But soon, now, well, this happens, but Savitri is human, Savitri is still. Satyavan is, of course, human, you see. Savitri is still human, you see. But soon, now, fade the summer's ardent breath. Again, summer, obviously, you see, he is moving on. The days are passing. I mean, they have come together, they are living together. Naturally, a young couple, they will be very intimately connected with each other, joining each other at every moment, at every day and night. Well, it's a kind of a honeymoon or what you want to call it, you see, of the relationship, you see. But the days are also passing quickly. The summer is coming to an end. But soon, now, fades the summer's ardent breath. Ardent because of their passionate intensity of love of their coming together, you see. And throngs of blue-black clouds crept through the sky. So this rain is coming now, shortly, you see. And rain fled sobbing over the dripping leaves. So all the leaves are making sounds, you see, sobbing over the dripping leaves. And storm became the forest titan voice. So really furious rains, you see, they have already arrived here. This is, of course, the picture of North India. This happens in summer, in June, July, you see. And storm became the forest titan void. Then, listening to the thunder's fatal crash, and the fugitive pattering footsteps of the showers, and the long, unsatisfied panting of the wind, and sorrow muttering with the sound vexed of the night, the grief of all the world came near to her. So, the rains have brought her grief. The ardent summer is over. Now the grief is coming to Savitri. And sorrow muttering, the sound vexed night. Sound vexed because of the pattering of the rains and all that. The grief of all the world, this is important, grief of all the world, Savitri's grief, is actually the grief of the entire world, came near to her. Night's darkness seemed her future's ominous face. Night's darkness, this is the meeting of the lovers in the night. So even in that meeting, the grief comes to her, to Savitri. It's not the day, you see. Night's darkness seemed her future's ominous face. Savitri is now connecting this darkness of night with the day which is advancing very fast. Day told by Narad that 1 year after the marriage he will die. So that memory is now getting awakened in Savitri, although she is enjoying the relationship with Satyavan, you see. Night's darkness seemed her future's ominous face. The shadow of her lover's doom arose, and fear laid hand upon her mortal heart. Obviously, she is now afraid. There is a kind of a dread now in her breast. Yes, shortly he will die. So that is now kind of piercing into her breast, into her heart. And fear laid. Savitri otherwise has no fear, but in the union of the lovers, suddenly this happens now, and Savitri sees that, well, this is going to happen shortly now, that he won't be there anymore. Mortal heart. See, this is important, mortal. Mortal because he is describing the entire condition of human Savitri. The full aspect of human Savitri is what is being presented to us here. Full aspect of human Savitri. She is human in every respect. Emotion, passion, love, sex, whatever is there, she is there, she is full. And fear laid hand upon her mortal heart. The moment swift and ruthless raised, alarm, her thoughts, her mind, remember, Nara's day. 12 swift winged months are given to him and her. She is remembering now. Yes, Narada has already foretold Nati. The moment swift and ruthless raced, alarmed her thoughts. Her mind remembered Nara's date. Actually, Nara's date means he had described the day, the time, on which day, the time, the hour, and the moment. Everything is his memory. The day, the time, the hour, the moment. What the Sanskrit text says, Muhurtam, Kshanam, Velam, Divasam. Muhurtam, moment. Kshanam, hour. Velam, time. And Divasam, day. So she is remembering now, day, time, hour, moment. Yes, it's going to happen now. It's going to happen. So that thing is now constantly haunting her. You see, all the way. While she is in the embrace of her lover, she at once realizes, oh, it's going to happen now, shortly, you see. Her thoughts and mind remembered Nara's day. A trembling moved accountant of her riches. Yes, all the riches are there. Now she is keeping an account of all those riches, of all those beautiful moments of life with her husband. A trembling moved accountant of her, moved because she is passionate, she is emotional, she is charged. She reckoned the insufficient days between. Obviously, now it means that this is almost coming towards the end of the year. You see, she reckoned the insufficient days between. A dire expectancy knocked at her breast. Yes, it is going to happen shortly, shortly, shortly. Dreadful to her were the footsteps of the hours. The hours are moving swiftly, you see. Grief came, a passionate stranger to her gate. For Savitri, there was never the question of grief, but he is coming now to her as a guest, a passionate. Yes, I demand my share. This is what the grief is telling her, Savitri. Grief came, a passionate stranger to her gate. At the doorstep, now he's standing, that grief. Banished when he's in arms, when Savitri is in the company of Satyavan, then there is no question of grief at all. The guest is dismissed. The stranger has to walk away when he's in his company. Out of her sleep, it rose at morn to look into her face. So morning when she gets up, again she awakens to grief. In the night, she is in the happy company of her lover. Morning, she awakes to the grief standing at the doorsteps there. Vainly, she fled into the visions of bliss. From her pursuing foresight of the end. Vainly she fled. She wanted to go away into that depth of bliss which is there in the company of her lover. Abyss, in the depth, profound bliss in the company of her lover. She wants to go and live in that, but vainly, because that grief is knocking at her door. Vainly she fled into abysms of bliss. From her pursuing foresight of the end. The more she plunged into love, that anguish grew, obviously. She is enjoying the company of her lover. But the more and more she enjoys, the more and more she feels the pain of the arriving time. Her deepest grief from sweetest gulfs arose. Her deepest grief from sweetest gulfs arose. Sweetest girls, the abysms of bliss. Sweetest girls, abysms of bliss. The depths of bliss, the profundity of bliss of their union, of their being together. From that depth arose grief. See, this kind of a construction is typically Aurobindonian. Heart deepest grief from sweetest gulf arose. The contrast, very dramatic statement. It's a very dramatic statement. Heart deepest grief. And see the structure, her deepest grief. Her deepest means I am. From sweet, again I am. Girls, a rose, all are I ams. Her deepest grief from sweet girls, a rose. Short, long. Poetically, very beautiful sentence, you see, also. Remembrance was a poignant pang. Obviously, she feels the poignancy of Satyavan's absence. Remembrance, when he is no more with her, he is not with her, he has gone away for work in the day, and Savitri is without him, then it is that moment of remembrance. She remembers about her Satyavan all the while. And that was a pang. She felt each day a golden leaf torn cruelly out from her too slender book of love and joy. Her book of love and joy is a very slender book. Just 1 year, you see. Hardly 365 pages, you see. You see, for that. It should be actually 365 into 100. That is why it is a slender book. From her too slender book of love and joy. Thus, swaying in strong gusts of happiness. So you can see the kind of a seesaw game being played in her emotional heart. She is happy, she is grieving. She is happy, she is grieving. She is happy, she is grieving. She is happy in the company of her lover. She is grieving because he will be no more there tomorrow, constantly. Thus, swaying in strong gusts of happiness and swimming in foreboding somber waves. So that is this way. Swaying is this one. Gust of happiness is one part. And foreboding somber waves. That is the second part of it. And feeding sorrow and terror with her heart. For now they sat among her bosoms again. Sorrow and terror are sitting in the heart of Savitri. Bosom's guest, as they are standing there, they are sitting there as her guest. Or in her inner chamber, paced apart. Inner chamber, well, sorrow and terror will go. At the same time, joy and happiness also will go. So they will put apart like that. Her eyes stared blind into the future's night. So she is looking at the night. Tomorrow, what is going to happen? She has no knowledge at all. No light is there at all for her to discern what is going to happen tomorrow. Out of her separate self, she looked and saw. Now, this is important. This is really yogic. Out of her separate self, while Savitri is so intensely emotional, charged with passion and grieving also simultaneously, sorrow and terror and abysms of bliss, both of them there simultaneously. Yet, she has the tremendous capacity to stand apart from them, to get detached from them. Separate self. She is looking at them now as a witness purusha, as a sakshi. She is observing them. She is simply observing. She is an observer now. Out of a separate self, she looked and saw. So already even in her human state, there is that yogic poise in Savitri. Moving amid the unconscious faces loud, So all these people who are there around, she is moving with them as a separate self. In mind, a stranger, though in heart so near, the ignorant smiling world go happily by. Yes, the whole world is merrily going on. What grief is there in the heart of Savitri? Nobody knows. Neither Satyavan, nor his parents, nor the great rishis of the ashrama. Nobody has knowledge what Savitri is feeling, that pain. In mind, a stranger, though in heart so near, they are all very close to her. But they are stranger in their mind. They cannot understand her mind, her psychological condition, her state. In mind, a stranger, though in heart so near, the ignorant, smiling world go happily by. Everybody is doing their routine activities. Upon its way towards an unknown doom, and wondered at the careless lives of men. So she is really wondering how these people really live it all. She is really wondering, careless lives of men, in that sense, you see. As if in different worlds they walked, in different worlds, the whole world and Savitri, they are living in two different worlds. Savitri is living in a separate self. People around her are living the normal human life. As if in different worlds they walk. Though close, yeah, they're all nearby, around, very intimate. They talk to each other, exchange greetings, happiness, joys, every day. They confident of the returning sun. Yes, the sun will come back tomorrow. Now the sunset is there, tomorrow it is bound to come. So they are confident of it. They are not aware of the doom which is waiting for the creation. They wrapped in little hourly hopes and tasks. She, in her dreadful knowledge, was alone. Nobody had an inkling of what is going to happen tomorrow. Unknown doom. They are not aware of this unknown doom. Nobody. They are merely doing their routine things day after day. But she, in her dreadful knowledge, was alone. Now you see, the richness of Savitri's poetry, when you come now to this yogic aspect, you look back about what he had described earlier, the fusing of the two fires into one fire. It's not there at all, in a sense. It is a different thing altogether. As if in different worlds walked, though close, they confident to the returning sun, they wrapped in little hourly hopes and tasks. She, in a dreadful knowledge, was alone. The rich and happy secrecy that once enshrined her, as if in a silver bower, apart in a bright nest of thoughts and dreams, made room for tragic hours of solitude. So, secrecy, that happiness which is there, it has made room for the tragic event to take place in her solitude, Savitri. Made room for tragic hours of solitude and lonely grief that none could share or know. Savitri's grief, nobody is knowing that thing, you see. A body seeing the end too soon of joy and the fragile happiness of its mortal love. Well, he is describing the condition of Savitri again. A body seeing the end too soon of joy and the fragile happiness of its mortal love. That is the tragic hour in the solitude Savitri is seeing here.